Here we are again. We continue now from a video. As those of you who watched the live stream which I gave this past Friday, either at the time or perhaps later, will have noticed, I hope, that when I went to play some recordings, all of a sudden we had a big problem with YouTube, that the recordings would stop. They would go on these videos or audio recordings, which I had. So I thought the best thing to do would be to actually stop the live stream a little early and continue with the recording part as a video. So here we are. Now let me explain once again. I come here and I want to play little selections from some recordings which were very important for me, actually still are very important for me. I was going to actually play a little bit also to sort of demonstrate how these were important to me, but I seem to have cut my finger. So it's going to wait, and I will do this, though, as soon as a couple days, I imagine, when this gets better. But I thought we should actually play through some of these recordings in any case. Now, why am I doing this? Because the idea for me, as I had mentioned in the introduction to the live stream also, is that education can take place in moments of, in a certain sense, I would say even epiphany. That's sort of a realization of something which can change completely the way we were thinking before. We learn, we get all this information and this and that, but especially if we're dealing in the arts, in how to do something, in how to understand what we are doing, what we should do, I'd say, this sense of just the moment of epiphany is very important. And what that means is that you can study every week constantly for years and get very little out of it, or you can have just a moment here, a moment here, a moment here, and those moments will be life-changing. There's, as I see it in education in general, a big problem of the corporatization of education and the regimentation of education. That's even now in schools, you get messages that we have to set our goals. So after the semester, the student has to learn this. This semester, the student has to learn this. They have to learn this. They have to learn that. I find that absolutely ridiculous. And I look back to people who were, in many ways, my mentors. One person, of course, was a great composer, Elliot Carter. Another one was the other great composer, Milton Babbitt. And I look at my students for now, and I look at myself. And I somehow feel that I'm much more educated than my students. Yet, I didn't have so much regimentation, so much testing, so much rehearsal. But now I look at Elliot Carter, or of course Milton Babbitt, who was maybe the most educated person I've ever met. It's remarkable. I think he knew everything. Another one was Charles Rosen, of course. That's all basically from the same generation, although Carter was, of course, the oldest of them. Now I go back to Carter, And his education is so much more vast, or was so much more vast, than mine. And yet, he went to school at a time when you did not have testing like this, when you did not have regimentation, when everything was very loosely, in a certain sense, personal. So here we have, in my own experience, a direct inverse correlation between the institution of strictures of education, of actual posts, goalposts, and actual education. Okay, that's enough of that harangue. I think I've spoke about that much earlier, and I will speak about this again. Now I come to the recordings, and the reason is that even though I had wonderful teachers, I learned so much from historical recordings, so-called historical recordings. Now they're all historical. Maybe at the time when I was listening to them, they were a little less historical, but some were actually still very historical. Historical, whatever. Anyway, and as I always mention, I feel very lucky to have had the parents which I had. We were wonderful musicians, especially my father, who had very ecumenical taste, but very good taste in music, and exposed me from a very early age in these historical recordings. So he also exposed me to a lot of very contemporary music from when I was basically a baby, I would say. And that's another topic which I will talk about in more detail. I talked about it earlier, about that, how what that did was it gave me a certain sense that music is music, whether it is music with a nice melody or music with a melody that someone would say, oh, this is not nice, but I would think, oh, this is not so bad, it's pretty nice. Or would have no melody at all, but would have just effects of this way. But for me, this was all very understandable, because I grew up with it. And I wish that everyone would grow up with it. My harangue about new music and issues of that will wait. Oh, I should say a re-harangue, because very early on I did speak a lot about it. But I will speak about this more in a little while, but not now. So what I want to do is start with little bits, even sort of just gestures, which were very important for my musical development. And I begin with this from the Prod Festival. And this is, I had it there, but I forgot exactly what the dates are. 1952, I believe. Yeah, 1952 is correct. The Prod Festival still exists, but is not what it was at the time. It was quite a fantastic festival before I was born. That is, but in any case, this is the Brahms' first piano trio, this Opus 8. Maybe you do. Here, I give it once again there. And it's in the third movement, the Adagio movement. Actually, I should say. Yeah, I think that's all I will play today. and just little bits of it. And I should mention. No. Okay. I still leave this in, even though it's a mistake. It's a mistake on my part, not on the electronics part. The three people, the trio, are the pianist Myra Hess, wonderful pianist, and one of my favorite artists, historical artists, I would say. Isaac Stern, the violinist, at a very young age at that time. And, of course, the great Pablo Casals playing cello. So I play just a little bit of the first movement, and then I will go to the part which really influenced me. Wonderful to play the whole movement, but I think that just the whole work itself, but it would take too much time with everything I need to do. But even in this beginning, what impressed me was the sense that the motion, the melodic motion, I would say, leads the tempo. And this is somehow, you have this nuance of the moment. So certain things a little bit fast, certain things a little slower, this way, that way. And this is just very much what Brahms himself meant when he talked about flexible tempo. This way. Okay. So everything has a very strong sense of rhythm. But the rhythm has this flexibility, which is essential to classical music to our music. Anyway, should I say our music? Anyway, a little too possessive. Okay, now I go on to the one part which was especially important, I felt, when I first listened to it. You get a little bit earlier. This is from the Adagio. The first one was from the first movement, but this is the Adagio. That's to stop it now, unfortunately. This is a very remarkable performance, I found. And Casal's playing is a tremendous example of finding the nuance of the moment. And yet, the moments are connected. And they're connected by memory. So the repetition has a relationship to what went before. But that relationship is more of a comment on it. So I remember this, but it's not simply that, oh, this is what I'm doing, but it's remembrance of what was and taking that and saying that, but now I have a different sense. And that made a very big impression on me. Okay, now I move to another recording. From this. And this is Beethoven Violin Concerto in the performance of Fritz Kreisler from 1926 with the conductor is Leo Blech. This way. Okay. Let me do this in a better way, I think, here. I'm having a little trouble with this. That's okay. Again, it's Fritz Kreisler once again, 1926, the beginning, with Leo Blech conducting the Berlin State Opera Orchestra at that time. Okay. And I think that I will. I'm going to play some bit of the. Here we go. The introduction, which is rather long, is that also impressed me quite a bit. Stop this now, but I will continue with it because that's it. But I wanted to just mention how in this introduction, Blech creates a whole world of the piece. In other words, he summarizes all the different moods which will come in the rest of this first movement. That also made a very big impression on me. And how the tempi are different, yet somehow make perfect sense because they describe the character of the moment in a very, very clear way. Okay, now we go on. This is the entrance of the violin, and Kreisler will be playing. And I'll play just a little bit of that as well. I'd love to play the whole thing again. Stop now, just because that little scale going up to the melody actually made a huge impression on me when I first heard it. I don't know how young I was. But I was already playing the clarinet, I think, when I heard this first. I have to say that my father had this wonderful collection of 78 records. This is before you had long playing records, way before there were CDs, and way before there was streaming audio, of course. But the sound of the 78s, even though it was had a lot of, I should say, dirt in it, was somehow much more beautiful than what we have now. And that little scale going up at the end, somebody said, I listened to it, and I said, even though I play the clarinet, I say, that has to be my articulation, my staccato. Not for every piece, but in general, I had to. So, this is another thing I wanted to talk about, and I had started talking about it during the live stream, the idea of actually copying, and how the idea of how copying is not bad, but in fact is something that is essential, I think. So what I set about to do on the clarinet, I look about it, maybe kind of funny now to think about it, was first to play the Beethoven violin concerto. You know, I don't know if I was how old I was, maybe 12, 13 years old, something like that. Play it with that articulation in the beginning, just to try to imitate what that was. And I kind of somehow internalized that. And then, of course, my playing was never Chrysler's playing, and of course I dabbled in the Beethoven concerto, and I thought it was so much fun to actually to learn the piece as I did, but it's something that's not serious. There's been clarinetists doing this, but I think that's also not serious, but I don't talk more about that. Anyway, just the little nuance there, and to copy the nuance that it's like I wanted in another piece, I would work on other pieces, but I wanted to copy the sense of Casals, for instance. Then I was, so, okay, so that's that. And I'm going to go a couple more. Sorry, I'd love to play more of this, but I go onward. And to another of the instrumentalists who were very important for me when I was just starting out as a student or pre-student, I would say. And this is David Oistrakh, the great violinist, Russian, Soviet, you could say at the time, violinist. And somehow, again, my father had many recordings of his, which were all, I think, bootleg recordings just taken from broadcasts that he gave in the Soviet Union, in Moscow, etc. But, of course, everything that they did in Moscow at that time was also a bootleg kind of process. So, in any case, I even forgot the name of the records that I have them somewhere in some closet, which I couldn't get rid of them, but what the company was. But anyway, what's wonderful is that I could find one. This is a Tchaikovsky concerto that they did, and it's actually not the recording which I grew up with, which was his earlier recording, which was done from the 1930s, in fact, but later one from 1968. And this is with the conductor, Rozhdestvensky, Gennady Rozhdestvensky, in Moscow Philharmonic Orchestra. But the reason I'm playing this is because it is actually a video. So I'd like to play that as video. There is the earlier recording. I did find it on YouTube, but it's not a video. So I thought this is more interesting. Here we have it.
Thank you.
Okay, I have to stop it here. Yeah. So what I want to say about this, I was actually lucky enough to have heard him several times when he came to New York. I was little. And what was very important for me was, first of all, the kind of unforced power of the playing. And also the sense of his motion, which always was with the music happening. And again, the sense of the nuance of the moment. In, of course, in pieces like Tchaikovsky, which is was his really bread and butter. But I want to go and play a bit of a recording that I have, which is not on YouTube itself, but it may be on YouTube, but I don't know. But it's was originally an LP that I had, and then I got it as a CD, was able to find it, so I can actually play it now since I have no record player or anything of that sort. And luckily, I could find my little CD drive, CD-ROM drive, here. Okay, and this is David Oistrakh, and his favorite pianist, who is Frieda Bauer. And there are YouTube videos of them together, but I wanted to play this because this recording, and I heard them play in New York together, with, and also with Prokofiev, other works. It's made a big impression on me, and but I only actually found the recordings when I went and studied in Moscow first, and then when I came back and I lost everything, and then I found this on CD. So I want to play this for you. And this comes from a recital that they gave in Prague. And this must have been in 1972, actually, according to here. Okay. It's getting, little machine's getting ready for this. This is the Brahms' first violin sonata. It's G major, opus 78. That's really, and again, and the performance that made very big impression on me. Okay, this is 5. And I'll just play you some of the first movement. See, maybe I'll play the whole first movement.
Thank you.
will finish for the moment. I have more recordings, and I will periodically, I think starting quite soon, play more snippets, perhaps longer segments. I'm worried about playing the whole pieces for various issues of copyright, etc., etc. But as we figure that out more, maybe we'll be able to put more on the channel. And here, this performance, this, I think, quite remarkable performance. What impresses me even now, is aside from the overall scope of it, the wonderful sense of sort of journey that we have, I won't even say form, I'll say journey, is the way that Dati has a different character in different places. It's always the same gesture, but it is different. And that has also made a big impression on me. And hopefully it will get you, perhaps, or some of you at least, thinking a little more along these lines. And along the lines that if there is something that particularly impresses you, you can actually try to copy it, okay? And then you internalize it, what you have copied, and it's no longer a copy, and it will actually be quite different because you are different from what you heard. But you will have learned something very important from that. Take care, everyone. I hope that this actually works out, this sort of hybrid experience with the live stream and then this video, which I think is much better than probably the live stream itself. So take care. Bye now.